Well, hello, everybody. Good evening and welcome along to the Dundee Stars live show. Omar Pasha and myself, joined by Justin Farina a little bit later on. And a very exciting show up. And well, that was a nice bit of news that released to everybody just an hour ago or so, Omar, about the online store and how everyone could buy some lovely Stars merchandise now.
No, it was our, I guess, announcement we wanted to make. There's a lot of prep in the background now with that to launch us off. We have a lot of nice, kit that people can purchase. And no, I'm excited about it. I don't know if anybody noticed, but I wear a lot of Savvy stuff during the show. So now I just felt that as a club, we wanted to take that next level. And again, it kind of tied up with the return of our main sponsor, Kitmark, for this this upcoming season, whenever it happens. So, we're excited to have them back and the support that even if there's a season, or if there's not, well, they're on board. So that's great for them. And again, a few shout outs to the other sponsors too, to make that commitment, whether there is a season or not. But good for them. And we're glad to have them on board, and they make some really cool stuff. There's a 10% discount code for all the fans now till next Sunday. So use that code if you want to get a small discount. And it's just a way to not only support the team, but show some true colors.
Yeah, but don't do it right now. Don't do it right now unless you can multitask and you've got two devices.
Yeah, I know.
that discount code will remain active, as Omar says, until a week on Sunday, Omar?
Yeah, a week on Sunday. So next
week on Sunday. So don't go anywhere. You can leave here at 8 o'clock. Browse the store.
8 o'clock. You think this show will finish at 8 with all the pictures you guys probably have?
In fact, that's a good point. If anyone is planning to leave at 8 o'clock, it's not going to happen. Maybe 8:40 to 9. Let's go 8:40 to 9. Just as a safe bet. That's usually when we leave. But a lot going on this week, Omar, all over the place. Of course, a lot of talk about the season and such like. Have you got any comments to make?
I do, and I don't know if I should, but I do. But I think yesterday, I think the league missed the boat by not announcing that through the league and not giving the awareness to the 10 teams for the announcement. Listen, everybody now knows that the decision is most likely going to be made middle of September. I think we're all aware that there's a probability of the season playing, and there is a high probability of the season not being played. The one thing I'll say is, listen, we've been preparing from the end of last year for this season. There was a lot of downs, obviously, with COVID and with the situations of working with governments and obviously with our fans. But since the beginning, we wanted to stay optimistic. And I think everybody knows that, right? We were optimistic. So we obviously gathered season tickets. As I said on the show before, as I wrote in a press release, all the season ticket will be reimbursed if there's no season. So we don't have to worry about it. So no fan has to worry about that. There's other plans we have in place if there is no season. We're launching a new membership program that we're going to have to talk about here relatively soon, because it's going to be a great package for the fans to help us grow the club even further for if there is no season, or if even there is a season, we want to take that next step. And listen, I just want to say this, like it's obviously we're living in really weird times and really tough times. But I think as a club, we will do everything in our possible to come back stronger than ever. And the thing that kind of disappointing for me, I think that decision or that announcement should have came from the league that would have allowed us to answer a lot of those questions and attack those questions directly, rather than playing a lot of catch up and a lot of firefighting today. So I wasted a lot of time today to one specific person or club, so expect an apology from them.
Well, there you are. You've heard it.
Apology. Hey, listen, if they want to send me one of these, that would be nice, you know, or one of these, but they have to go through our shop to get them.
Yeah, and they should use the discount code, right? Because they might want to save a bit of money. I don't know.
Well, if they use a discount code, that's appreciative from their standpoint, because they can save them money. So even if I'm asking them to purchase something from the club, I'm also giving them a discount code as well, you know? So, you know, everybody wins. But just to go back to the, to what I said, listen, we've done this for the first, we've done this for 20, how many weeks we've done this now? 19 weeks. We probably have.
This is the 20th show, Ma.
This is the 20th show. We probably have one of the most, I would say the most famous, one of the most famous players the Dundee Stars have ever had. And a very nice person, a very good guy that we're going to talk about. We're going to have the privilege to have. But we are always prepared for these. So the transparency goes back to a bit of our, what we talked about earlier in other shows, how we want to grow the league. And hopefully this is a learning curve where if there is no season, and I'll say this, if there is no season, this is a good opportunity. Like, we've taken this opportunity to grow as a league and we as a club, and we want to get better. Every day we want to get better. And this is maybe an opportunity, if there is no league, to take that lead to the next level. So that's just my opinion. Listen, who am I to say? So I'd rather not tweet it out. I'd rather just say it.
Yeah, I don't think we need to discuss your antics with Jenny this week after that. I think that was quite a good opener.
No, give me a break with Jenny. She's been treated like a princess as every week. But she's doing well, yeah.
Are you sure no one's
got
any... The
love of my life, Jenny, she is. The love of my life.
They are. Yeah, you said it. So he's opened up and done everything tonight. Well,
she did a few great meals this week. A good, nice steak pie. She did also a nice fajita plate for me. So I've been treated well. And you know, I joke around a lot about Jenny, but and I'm sure everybody, when they went through lockdown, they were alone or they were with somebody. I had probably the best lockdown ever, spending as much time with Jenny. Oh, wow, that was awesome. Brownie points.
Yeah, exactly. Heck yeah. No, and the perfect way for you to finish that off tonight, Omar, is order a nice takeout once the show's finished.
Yeah, we'll see about that.
Yeah, you probably will. During the show, think about what you're going to order, because I have a few fans who have been asking over the last few weeks, what is Omar ordering for his takeout? So you need to tell us after near the end of the show.
So the strategy is Justin ready, or is he? I don't want to bore him with this story.
I'm waiting on Wayne's confirmation. So you go for that story.
Okay. So for the takeout. So what happens usually? Okay, Justin is ready. I won't say that.
We need the story first, and then
long story short, what happens on a Friday? There's always that 20-minute conversation. We don't know what's happening. I don't know what's happening. She kind of wants something that's close by, so I go get hers. I stop by. I get mine. So everybody's happy at the end of the day. But hopefully tonight we'll both eat the same thing. But let's bring Justin over. We don't need to talk about mine.
Let's bring him on, Justin Frena. Let's be honest. The main man of the Dundee Stars, loved man. I've never seen a player come, Omar, back after leaving a club with huge banners. It was like Justin Frena night the first night he stepped back in the rink after leaving, and his time in Dundee, absolutely sensational. Fans loved him. The coach loved them. Everyone at the club loved them. 100% commitment.
I didn't like playing against him.
Well, we're going to get onto that later on. And you're lucky. I mean, he can't get to you through a screen. You see, we had to do this interview like this. That was the only reason we did it, for your own protection, Pash. But let's bring on Justin Frena.
Hey, how's it going?
Oh, Justin Frena. That's up there with Ua Bakala. So those are my two favorite songs for Justin.
I know. That brings back memories.
Justin, how are things with you? How's things been with lockdown and such like?
Yeah, good. Working from home a bit there, so that was nice. I was able to do that, very blessed during these times. Kept busy. And obviously it's, you know, it's just adjusting but back in the office now and everything's kind of getting back in the swing of things slowly but surely. And I don't know how it is. Well, I know it's pretty bad there, but Calgary, you know, it's a bylaw now, wear a mask. And so, you know, it's different, and explaining things to Noah and trying to get him to keep his mask on when we're going places, and you know, kids are so. But no, it's the lockdown's been okay for us.
Yeah, Noah, I was going to ask, is it how much of a challenge it's been for him? Of course, the world's changing, and I suppose kids just don't really understand it that much.
No, poor guy. Actually, we had a family vacation, once a lifetime trip to Disney that got canceled because of COVID. And then he's got his birthday during COVID. So, yeah, try explaining that to a four-year-old is it's pretty tough. So, tough one. Tough one for Noah.
Yeah. Have you done some homeschooling then?
Yeah, a little bit of home. Yeah, Kelsey kind of took control of that, I guess. And it wasn't as bad. It's preschool. So, it was only a few minutes, but no, it was good. Mm-hmm. He was pretty good.
I'm just going to remind people before we get any further in discussion that you can send questions in for Justin at the end of the show, and we will not be able to read them all out because there'll be too many, but we will get to some of them. And if you've got anything for Omar as well, send them in as well, because that was the most fiery entrance he's ever done to a show, Justin. He must have saved that for episode 20, your show, you know. But
well, his old GM had to do that. So anyways, that's another story. Yeah. Listen, Justin, I wanted to start, Dundee obviously had the privilege to have you, but talk us through not only your decision, but obviously playing college hockey in the United States, and maybe give us a quick roundup and the ultimate decision to get to end up in Dundee eventually.
Oh, geez. So basically spent 3 years at University of Wisconsin-Superior. Cut it short, actually, and decided to sign with Rapid City as basically a walk-on tryout my senior year. And that year happened to be the lockout. So I was kicking myself a bit because I was going, oh, what did I do? I could have just stayed. But once you sign a contract, that's it for NCAA. Like, you're done. Mm-hmm. So I was kind of kicking myself going, what did I do? And so went to camp in Rapid City, obviously lockout. And ended up getting sent down to Fayetteville and was there for about a couple of weeks and got the call up. And I remember I was going, oh, geez, like, well, how long am I going? It was like 5 a.m. and I got the call and they're like, yeah, your plane leaves at 8:00. You got to drive all the way to Raleigh to catch the plane. And you're playing tonight and Rapid. And I'm like, holy, how long am I going for? And they're like, 2 weeks. So I packed a bag, just a duffel bag, jetted out the door. And I ended up staying for 3 years, but it was pretty crazy. I remember I was living out of a duffel bag for months, and all my stuff was in Fayetteville, North Carolina. So, my time in Rapid, that's where I got my start basically, and it's what I knew for 3 years. I had my spot as third line center. That was my role. I killed penalties, I'd fight, I'd chip in where I could. And I did that for 3 years. And it was just kind of like the same, the same song and dance. It didn't matter how hard I worked or how well I was doing. I was always kind of pigeonholed in that position as a third line center. So it was tough for me to, I just needed a change. And I needed something new. I needed a new opportunity. And so actually Scott Ray talked to Lefebvre. That's how I got connected with Lefebvre. And he gave me a call and, I talked to Scott a little bit about, Lefebvre. And so I remember the conversation. He's selling me on Dundee and what it was like to play over there and, how much, play with three lines. I was going to get an opportunity, and he was looking for some toughness as well, especially when going into those smaller rinks like Cardiff, right? They needed a little more toughness. And so he wanted to bring me on board so I was excited to get to Dundee, and that's kind of how I got there. The rest is kind of history, I guess.
Did you expect, what were you expecting when you signed with Dundee, Justin? Of course, you wouldn't have been familiar with the Elite League and Dundee itself. Or what was your genuine at the time feeling and thoughts before you even got here?
Well, actually, I was kind of surprised that there was hockey in the UK. Like, I had no clue, no idea, right? Dundee, I was kind of like, where's Dundee? Scotland? Oh, they, you know, so I was surprised. And then I was, and then, you know, you kind of, you ask around, you guys you've played with or that happen to have been over there and whatnot and get their perspective on it and their take. And it was kind of geared towards me, right? It was still kind of North American feel where there's hitting and fighting was so loud opposed to other European leagues. And I just remember, I think it was Simsy sent out a tweet or something. Dundee was running out of, must be low on the budget or whatever to sign me or whatever it was. And that kind of stuck with me that year, to be honest with you. That kind of gave me a little fire because I was like, who is this guy? I'm going to show this guy, you know. But talking about, you know, he hasn't even seen me play and he's already bashed me before I even got there. So that kind of gave me a little spark to, you know, make him eat his hat, I guess you could say, or, you know, so. I was going there and I was going to do what I did and work hard and be ready for every game and provide that spark for the team when needed. Just a great group of guys. Like those 2 years were the best years that they were in my career. I wish we really could have brought home some hardware at Dundee. That's the biggest thing is that still doesn't sit right with me, I guess, is just, I would have loved to do, you know, it's just frustrating to think, you know, how hard we worked and everything we went through and kind of nothing to show for it, but that final four was special.
What was your thoughts, Justin, obviously playing in the ECHL for a few years before and coming to the league? What was your initial thoughts of the league? What was your initial thoughts of Dundee and you know, the city and everything initially?
Yeah, I mean, it was all kind of, you get off that plane and it's just kind of, you're in a different world, right? You're jet-lagged and you're looking around and going roundabout, you're getting dizzy all the roundabouts you're going through, roundabout. No, it's just, it was different. Everything was different. It's just the way of life is different, obviously, from North America. The rink, you know, you see on the curling circles there on the rink, and you're kind of like, what are we getting into here? But I loved it. I loved, you had more room, you had more time. You could use your speed. You could kind of, I don't know. It was just, it's a different game. Actually, it took me a while to get kind of back in the rhythm when I went back to the ECHL to get into the rhythm of things, just because I was so used to the time and space. And it's just, yeah, it's two different worlds. It really is.
And you were saying about like when you played in the ECHL, you were maybe pigeonholed in the third line role. And when you came here, you obviously produced offensively. What was that spark that you thought, obviously you were confident enough to think that before you came here, but when did you realize, okay, I can, you know, be a dominant player in this league? And when was that offensively, physically, when did you have that feeling?
Yeah, I mean, yeah, I see where you're getting at here with this question. It was, I think it was that yellow line, you know what I mean? There's the chemistry. And actually, funny story off the start, I remember being so mad that playing with Lidhammer, he was driving me nuts. And I remember telling Switzy, what's with this guy? Like, is he going to like figure it out here and start passing the puck and like getting on the same page? And it was funny, right? Because we ended up being so successful together. But I remember that first week or two, we got a new line mate. Like, who is this guy? And I joke about it with him lots too, right? But it was just, we clicked. I mean, we had the speed. Lidhammer would create space. I could create space. And little Switzy, the Buzz Bomber, could just wheel around and find one of us. They're both the playmaker kind of players, right? And it was just, all I had to do is get open because I knew as soon as one of them got the puck, they're going to be looking to pass it to me. And I knew I had to be ready. I knew they were going to get it to me and just be ready. And I knew I could I could put the puck in the net, right? So it was just really getting that chance. And Lefebvre gave us that chance. Like, you play with three lines there and you don't really have much of a choice, right? You got to play your guys. So that's what it is. That's what it comes down to.
No, even as a coach coaching against you guys, well, playing against you guys, that line was like you knew every game that you were kind of like, you know, at start of the season, maybe you're right. Maybe nobody really thought much of it. Switzer came out of college, Lidhammer out of Sweden, and you out of the ECHL, and you're thinking, okay, this is going to be a good line. But I thought you guys, every time we played against you guys, you really stuck out the way you guys played and the way you guys were fast and effective. And no, that was one of the, I would say, first of all, the most surprising line, but one of the, like, you guys were really hard to play against. And that was the most frustrating thing, I think, that a lot of teams would have said of that line, just had a bit of everything.
Yeah, we really did. We did have a bit of everything. And I remember we always knew each other. You know, when you talk, like, guys talk about playing with guys, certain guys, and they just knew where they were going to be and they knew how, you know, what they were going to do next. And it was that feeling, right? Like, I knew what Lidhammer was going to do every time he got the puck. He's going to cut around and or keep going and try to find me. And Switzer was always going to be just, you know, breaking down wide and creating space and finding, it was just, I don't know. It was just, we always knew where each other were going to be, and it just worked. Right. So, Lidhammer's physical, I was physical. We had the playmaking, they could both score as well. You know, it was just a little bit of everything, and we had the speed. So it was, yeah, it worked really well.
Justin, do you remember the first game that season where you thought, wow, this line is something, we're going to do something special here?
I think it was after the game in Manchester, actually. I just know it was, yeah, that's right. My point with Lidhammer, where I actually had a talk with him and I said, listen, like, we gotta play together. Like, let's start playing together. And then after that, it kind of clicked. I don't know what game specifically it was, but I remember having that chat and going, you know, you got to get on board here with Switzy and I, and we got to figure this thing out, and we can do it. And then it worked from that point on.
When you look at that season, Justin, of course, it was a disappointing end, I suppose. But was it for you a little bit better because you knew that you were coming back the next season and your line mates were as well?
Yeah, I mean, it's just a good feeling. Like, we were having a good year, and we all signed back early. Like, Switzer signed and Hartsey signed, I think, and I signed right after that, I believe. And it was such a great dressing room, and the guys just loved being around each other, and we're all happy to come back. And, you know, we got treated well. The fans were great to us. They're like family. And so why wouldn't we want to come back? You know, we're having success, and it, you know, the future looked bright. And so it was a no-brainer, really.
What was one thing you noticed of the difference between the fan base maybe in Rapid that was there and maybe the fan base in Dundee? That, you know, they're really passionate here, right?
Yeah, it's you know, you're getting cheesecakes and treats after the sweets. And I think I went home every week with a baggie for Noah with toys and whatnot. You know, it was like family. It really was. I mean, like, it was just like that personal level, right? It was all personal. It was all, you know, they'd wait for you after the game. Geez, I think I'd be in there sometimes forever. I'd be the last guy out, and, you know, you still had a big group there waiting for you. And, you know, it was different from everywhere else I played. Yeah, it was special. It really was. It was like family. I swear it was. And that's your family away from family, right? And so treated really well, just like one of their own, right? Like, that's how it is. And I still keep in touch with so many of those people that, you know, it's remarkable. What are we talking, like 3-4 years ago now? And, you know, still talk to them on Facebook here and there, and it's family.
Justin, is it more difficult, or do you feel more pressure when you've got that close family connection with the supporters and everyone in a club?
Yeah. You're going- Yeah, absolutely. Like, you don't want to disappoint, you know, I mean, you don't want to disappoint. Like, you're playing with your heart on your sleeve. And, you know, when you got a guy coming in the dressing room, giving you a heck, oh, geez, I'll never forget that. You know, it's just passionate. They're really passionate and a lot of history there and longtime fans. And it's just, you know, you really felt that. You really felt that passion and you know, win or lose, they were there. They were there. You know, if you got blown out or, you know, a lot different from a lot of other places, they still stuck behind you.
Well, that was interesting because that year, Justin, when you first came, I remember because that was my first year in Manch, and that was the year where Hull moved over to Manchester, and you guys, obviously, that was first year of Mark. So there was a bit of, I guess there was a bit of, you know, you guys didn't, the Stars didn't do well the year before, you know, they had that trouble a year, but for you guys to come in and, you know, I think you guys really, you know, had that, like the Stars had that bad season, but you guys coming in, you know, the fans were probably in, I would say like really happy and rejuvenated that you guys came and that you guys, you know, made a big difference and really a competitive team that year. And I still remember that for your first year, you guys, like, I remember came to Manch, we got smoked 7-1 and we were like, wow, this is legit now. The Stars are not the same team. And so for that aspect, you know, that's maybe one of the reasons why the fans were like, all right, we got something special right now.
Yeah, you could definitely see that. I think I remember it was like an exhibition game. It's like one of the first games. It was an exhibition game against Belfast. I think we lost by a goal or two goals, but remember coming out of the dressing room and, oh, great job tonight. Great. Like, that was great. And we're like, what? Like, we just lost, right? It was like, we just lost. And I'm like, yeah, but you didn't get blown out 7-0 or 8-0, right? And we're like, geez, what kind of year, you know, what kind of year did you guys have last year? So, no, I think they're, yeah, it gave them some new life and some excitement. And, yeah, I think you're right there.
Yep, probably Omar as well. The year before that was a terrible year, but I think one of the moves the club did that year was those guys that had really found a place in people's hearts and the fans really wanted to keep, they were signed early, I suppose. So it kind of felt like a journey maybe, Justin, from that moment when you guys started getting announced as signing for the next season, that there was always going to be a more. It wasn't going to end at the end of that year.
Yeah, exactly. And I don't think did they even have any imports from the year before signed back? Was there any? I think everyone was a fresh face, you know, besides like the John Dolan or, you know, I think everyone was a new face.
Yeah, no, I think it was from memory. I think everybody, I think Mark had kind of brought in a fresh stance. I think it was just the British players that come back. But you know, from that first season, what's one of your proudest moments you can remember, or one of the happiest things that you don't forget?
From the first season?
Yeah.
Jeez, you're really making me think now. I think the Fitzgerald fight, the Fitzy fight, I think that was one of those things that it's the intimidation, right, of the game and you know, it just, when you're playing against players that are intimidating like Fitzy and the Rose Hills have you and whatnot, it's just, you play, I don't know, it's like you're always looking over your shoulder kind of thing, right? Guys are a little uneasy, they're not comfortable until somebody kind of takes care of it. And I think that allowed guys to play their game. Mm-hmm. You know, I think it took the fear, right? Because they didn't have to deal with them, right? They knew it was taken care of. So I think that changed a lot. I don't know how I word it, but I think that let guys play their game, you know, instead of being scared to go in the corner in front of the net with Fitzy. They were able to play a little bit more.
Mm-hmm. I agree. That was a good fight, though.
Yeah, I mean, I don't think he really expected what he told me after we talked. He's like, man, great job. He goes, I definitely didn't expect that. I was like, thanks.
He's actually one of the nicest guys, Tim.
Yeah, he is. Yeah. And he's from Duluth, so when it was just across the bridge from where I went to school in Wisconsin. So, yeah, he always talk about Duluth with me here and there.
Yeah.
He's a really super, super nice guy.
So for you, Justin, like the one thing I wanted to ask you is obviously you have the guys that season and you guys fall a bit close. Well, you had that Cardiff series that was, you know, that you fell short, but it was a really good series, good season. Second season, now, what was the thoughts before the season? Did you put yourself in the club and maybe higher expectations? What was the thought process throughout the summer? Obviously, you signed early, but because you had a lot of success during the latter part of the season and coming so close to make the Final Four, what was that feeling and whether the guys coming back and that summer feeling like, all right, we're going to have another positive season?
That was it. And like our expectations were a little bit higher, right? I think that first year we did really well in the Challenge Cup at the beginning and, you know, fell short. And then it was always Cardiff that kind of stopped us in our tracks. Right. And it just sat with us. I remember after that first year, just sat with you all summer, kind of like, you know, we're so close. I think it was, I don't know, a couple penalties later on in the game that cost us. And it was just like, you could taste it. You know what I mean? It was just like, we can do it. Like we had that confidence. It was just like getting over that hump. You know what I mean? That's what we needed to do. And then we finally, because I think my whole time there, we finally got matched up with Bayhead and it wasn't Cardiff. And we're going, here we go, right? Like, we don't have to play Cardiff to get through. Like, it's Brayhead. So, we carried that. You're right. I just remember coming back, and that was the goal. That's what we all wanted. And that's why it still sits with me today. Like, it's just like, I wish we could have brought, you know, some hardware to Dundee. It's just unfortunate because the guys worked so hard. We went through so much together as a group, and each guy wanted it. That was a thing, right? We didn't have anyone that was kind of, you know, on the fence and just there to be there. You know, everyone wanted to win.
Mm-hmm. Which one was the most challenging season, you would say? Because you faced a lot of injuries.
Second season, no questions asked. Mm-hmm. We went through injuries and I had a groin injury. Brennan's back was messed up. Fallon, Joe played over 3,000 minutes, I think, that year, and he was just cooked. Like, the guy was falling apart on the bus, and he was walking into the North Sea in the morning for an ice bath. No joke. Like, it was unbelievable. The guys were just always banged up, and Tanaka, and it was like whoever was ready to play, it was like, okay, like, you guys kind of got to carry it tonight, right? It was, and that's where we kind of got into that system. I remember going into Lefebvre's office when we were playing Cardiff, and we're like, we're bagged. We're dead. And these guys, that's the game, right? Cardiff, you just tire the other team out. You try to do the cycle, hold on to the puck. And that's when we finally decided, like, we need something new here. Like, guys are dying. We're running out of energy, chasing these guys in the corner. Then we get beat, and then they get their opportunity. Mm-hmm. And that's when we came up with the box them out. Just let them do their thing. Let them hang on to it at the side, and we'll just stand there and recoup. That was the whole idea, is to keep our energy, because we were dying. We couldn't keep chasing them around. Mm-hmm. And then, it ended up working out. We stuck with it. And I think we beat Sheffield with it. They didn't know what to do. And Cardiff, I think, ended up winning in overtime. But we had some success with it. We literally just waited to go on the offense. So it worked great at the time because that's what we needed. We just didn't have the energy. We didn't have the bodies to keep up with a four-line team.
How was that conversation? Were you gassed when you went into Mark's office? Or?
Yeah, I was like, I can't keep – chasing Hotham all the way down past the goal line and around the net and on the other side. I was like, we need to come up with something here. because this isn't working. I was like, let him just skate around to the other side. I was like, I'm done skating all the way down and around the net. And right. So he's like, yeah, okay. Yeah. Yeah. No, I get it. And so he's like, well, let's just do this. Perfect. So it ended up working. But yeah, I remember being gassed and in his office and just going like, I can't keep chasing down to the bottom of the ice.
So it's your fault that the league had to play that so frustrating system against, right?
Yeah,
it's your
fault. Scott Brandon too. We're sitting next to each other and we're talking to each other like, this has got to, like, we can't just keep doing it. This is not working, right? We're gonna get killed here. And then that's kind of where it started. And I was like, I gotta go face on. We gotta get in there. But yeah. So I guess it started from Brandon.
how was that relationship? Because, you know, as a coach, I have a lot of relationships with a few of the players I trusted in the past where we can have those open conversations. Was that a conversation you felt comfortable to have with Mark too, whether it be at that time or another time? Was it an open door policy, you would think?
Yeah, it was. Me and Mark are along extremely well, and yeah, I did have that open door policy with him, and he really did listen to what I had to say and respected what I had to say, and I appreciate that. I think that's what makes Mark a good coach too, is he's receptive to feedback from his team, right? Mm-hmm. And it's one of those things where if you're trying to control everything, micromanage everything, and you're not listening to what the guys are saying, you kind of lose them. I feel like, you know, some coaches in the past, but you know, he's always willing to listen to the guys great relationship with Mark, and still talk to him quite a bit here and there these days as well.
Justin, going to that season, the second one, of course, you're a fan's favorite at the time, probably feeling a lot of pressure to produce the goods on the ice for the Stars. But how difficult was that, putting that together with also going to Dundee University and doing your school as well?
What a nightmare it was. Absolute nightmare. Jeez, you know, and then we had Noah going to the university. Yeah, great picture there. First day of school. But going to uni, and I remember having the conversation, you know, Mark calls me during the summer and he wants me to be the captain. And I said, Mark, like, I don't think I can handle that pressure. I was like, that's a lot, you know, on my plate. And just talking to Lou Dickinson, you know, about his experience and going to university and how much, you know, it consumed, you know, his time and still having to produce and just trying to be there for practice, you know, was a challenge. And mm-hmm. It was just like, how do you be captain when you can't even really get the practice, right? Like, so I had that conversation with him, and I knew sides coming in, and he was a leader and a guy I played with in the past. And I said, this is a guy, you know, that can lead us, that can do it. And I'd feel more comfortable being an assistant captain, because I just thought it'd be way, way too much on my plate, because it was a lot. Like, it was a tough balance. And it's just you. Like, I know it's different now. I think there's a few spots, right? So guys kind of help each other out. But I remember Tanaka actually kind of saved me a bit there. I remember I was kind of breaking down, and there's an assignment. I was like, I don't know. I was up.
Oh, hey, listen, are you listening, Justin? Don't say anything too much about school.
Yeah, no. I'm just saying. I was like there. I was up until like 2 a.m. I think. And trying to, you know, cram away at this paper and then going to practice the next day. And I was just a zombie. And like, I was like, are you all right, man? I'm just like, oh, yeah, I don't know, man. I don't know if I'm going to be able to get this paper done. Like, this thing's killing me. Because then we had to go on the road or whatever it was. We had a longer trip that weekend. And Tanaka kind of picked me up. He's like, I'll go to the library with you. And he was great, man. He really saved the day for me. And after that, I think it was pretty good. But I remember that at that point, I was like, holy man, this is tough. Like, it's a lot. So, yeah, for the guys going to school next year, your game face on. Yeah.
One thing I'll say, Justin, I want to cut you off because I think it's important for everybody to know this. With obviously yourself, leaving that impression. Lou did a good job. The one thing I'll say too, Swanee, is, and for the fans too, Justin has been a great ambassador for the club, regardless of everything, but even more importantly with the school itself. I know if you guys contacted Justin in the past, how was the school? And you got to remember, Justin, you were the only one that was at the school that year.
Yeah.
The following season, they gave us two schools, right? Yeah. They were able to because of the success of what you guys, what you and Lou did, but most importantly, you know, the I guess the impression and the how you left things with Dundee University. I think it was a great thing for the club. And the next year we had two, and this past year we had three. So the build up that we had with the university, and you know, with yourself and how you guys did a great job, has really not only solidified the relationship with the university, but has grown it further and further and further. And there's a lot of things I do with the university now, and that's mainly because of guys like you and Lou that just started. And that's a big thing, Justin. I think I cannot be more appreciative of the guys, how you guys started the school. Because if you went in and you just like, just give me A's and you didn't work hard, that relationship is done from the start. So yeah. I think everybody's obviously really happy with how you guys did at the start, for sure.
No, I appreciate that. And it was yeah, exactly. Like those guys, I think it was Mark Chevry, I think too.
Chevry did a good job too. Sorry.
Yeah. No. That's,
I apologize.
And then it was kind of like you had some big shoes to fill.
Yeah.
Because like, you know, Lou graduates with distinction, and it's like, oh, you know, those guys set the trends, right? So right off, like, you're right. So it's like you feel a little bit of pressure there as well, right? You got to come in and fill those shoes. And no, it's great to hear, you know, it's life changing. It really is. I wouldn't have the job I have today if it wasn't for, you know, that opportunity. And so I'm truly grateful. And you know, it's great to hear that there's two, three spots now. It's amazing. That really is, because it's life changing. And so that's great to hear. Really happy.
I think Justin, you're still her favorite, so you don't have to worry about that. You have Lissa's vote. I think she's you're still number one in her heart. So
yeah.
We got six next year. I think she'll be still talking about you.
Oh geez, that's awesome.
Well, I don't know. I know she loved Lou too.
She loves everybody.
Lou did really well in this class. So big things out of you. I'm like, oh geez, okay.
The one thing too, Justin, she would always say, I wish the students were a bit more vocal. I wish they were, you know, like Lou and Justin were a bit like Mark too. Or I'm like, well, good job. They said the bare heart. So I'm telling the guys back, I'm like, come on guys, get more involved in the uni. And they're like, well, what do you want me to do? You want me to just tell everybody to come to the game and say, yeah, that's what they did.
Yeah. I remember actually standing up and like saying like, yeah, hey, we got a game tonight. Like, they had a bus going from campus to, because that's the biggest thing, is the biggest feedback I got was how do they get there, right? Mm-hmm. It wasn't walking distance, so it was really, the rink's a little far to them, and so it was kind of like, well, okay, then they scheduled a bus to get a bus going back and forth. I don't know how that really went, but mm-hmm. Yeah, I remember that was the feedback. He's like, oh, it's way out there. Like, how am I supposed to walk out there, right? And then give some of those students credit. They did. Mm-hmm. They would walk, so.
Well, I remember there was you pushing it for that, because that's what I was hearing when I first came. There was you and there was Elliot Shaw, too. So he was doing the commercial side. So he was trying to push the students and yourself. So, no, you see, we still have a great following from the university. But that's still definitely some a strategy that we're trying to grow even more now, to get a student section, a streaming section.
That'd be awesome.
On probably.
But. And the thing is the awareness. Like if you were able to get like some banners of guys, kind of like they had in Brayhead in the mall, right? In Brayhead, you know, they got the banners of the players throughout the mall and whatnot. Like putting those on campus, because I'd be walking through campus, guy be wearing like a Rangers jersey. I'm like, oh, hey, like Rangers fan. And he'd be like, yeah, I'm from Canada, Toronto or whatnot. Yeah. Oh, yeah, like have you been to any Stars games? You'd be like, who are the Stars? Like the Dundee Stars, like it's the local team here. And then next thing you know, they're at every game, right?
Mm-hmm.
But they just didn't know.
Yeah, yeah. And that's the thing, we're still working on that every day.
Right. It's so, yeah, it's just, yeah, exactly. You know, and I hear you're doing a great job, and I see a lot of sponsors on that ice now. So things are changing. That's good.
Well, listen, Justin, I think we've had that chat a few times when I was trying to recruit you for another team. You know, the opportunity of Dundee growing, and you know, I really enjoyed that chat because Justin is really passionate about the Stars. And even if you were playing with Cardiff, obviously, I still think you have a place, you know, for the Stars in your heart. But he was always saying, oh, I think this could be big. I think this could be huge. And that's everything. Right. But it was a great conversation too when I had it with you, because I think I'll remember to today that conversation where I think I stole a few ideas off you. So
that's fine. <yeah. laughs>
Justin, at the end of your last season at the Stars, very special time. We've talked about it with many players, but Nottingham and the build-up before that with the games against Brayhead, as they were called at the time, yeah. But Glasgow, yeah, how special were they moments for you?
I want to say that first goal, game one against Brayhead at home, I think that's the goal I remember most. Like, out of, you know, I think that was the biggest goal I ever scored, was that goal. And we just rode the momentum from that point on. And I just remember just, like, that was our chance, right? Like, it was do or die. Like, that was really it. And everything we've been through, and yeah, this is it. And Switzer just puts, like, he did 30 times in the 2 years. I don't know how many times he did that. So it was like, I knew it was coming. It was like deja vu kind of thing, right? But that goal right there was, I think, the biggest goal I ever scored. It truly was.
Yeah, and I suppose one of the things I'm seeing here, actually, we looked at the footage.
Look at the energy, yeah.
Just when you were the first season you were here, but look at what you guys had achieved at the Stars with that.
Put that on full screen, Wayne. Put that on full screen.
But Justin, look at the crowd in that building. I mean, that kind of sums up what you guys did over two seasons, doesn't it? With the fact all those fans were there, and it really set Omar up actually for the season he came in terms of the crowd numbers and what he had to work with.
I remember talking to Mike Warren. He didn't believe that there's going to be sold out. He didn't believe there's going to be that many people. I'm pretty sure the building's going to be absolutely packed. To see the energy off that goal. Like, I mean, look at everyone just going nuts.
And I think to this day, they still don't know the crowd number. It's like our game this year against Fife. I think they're still trying to figure out what was the official.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
What can they write down?
Yeah. How did Lidhammer miss that? That's what I want to know.
Lidhammer, he needs to come on here to defend himself, Pat.
I know. I always give Lidhammer. But you know what? His chant, I love his chant.
You know what's funny? You know what?
Lidhammer. That was my favorite chant.
You know what's funny? Usually Vinny chirps everybody of that team. I haven't seen him come on, so I think he's scared of you, Justin.
Yeah, no, Vinny, geez.
He usually has a few digs on a few guys.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, he's always got some.
So when you went to, obviously, winning that game against, well, winning the series against Brad and going over to Nottingham, because I you know, I hear the stories, and we've had this chat with a few of the guys, but what was the buildup for that week? How exciting was that? Just the buildup, you know?
Oh, man. Yeah, I mean, the place, like the banners, and it was just, everyone was just, the place was just buzzing, absolutely buzzing before, like, yeah, that whole week is buzzing. And I don't know, it was just, we couldn't disappoint, you know what I mean? It was just like, this is it. We get the first crack at home in front of the fans, and yeah, it was great. You know, just great memories.
When you look at the playoff weekend, of course, you had with Dundee Stars, Justin, of course, you were there afterwards with Cardiff. How did it compare, like, different experiences? Because I suppose with the Stars, it was something special, because it was something that hadn't happened at all. It was the first time for the club, and yeah. In comparison to Cardiff, how did they compare?
Yeah, I mean, it's kind of strange, but that final four with with Dundee, I mean, I don't know. It was weird. Like, we didn't win. Like, we lost out, but we put everything on the table. Like, we put everything on the line, and the season we went through, and like I said, you know, all the adversity we faced, and to get there. I mean, like, Sheepdog. Like, it was, I think it was his first Final Four. Like, you know, how long he waited to, you know, get there. It was just, I don't know. It was a feeling like we did accomplish some. We did, you know, prove some people wrong, because everyone wrote us off in January. Mm-hmm. And to make it to the Final Four, it was kind of like, you know, we showed them, you know, we showed them that we, you know, we could do it. But yeah, it was just too bad. We just ran out of gas, you know, just ran out of gas. But
Cardiff,
I'd never won anything. So that was the first time I won a championship. I mean, we won the league. So that was the big thing, right? Winning the league. And it was different because it was kind of weird, right? You like win the league, you're skating around, and we're in Belfast and we're skating around, and it was okay. We did it. Like, we won the league, but we still got like 8 games to play or something, right? It was just like really strange. It was just like not, it wasn't, it was just a weird kind of, it's like we did it, we won, but it's still like, we're still going. I don't know. It was kind of weird, but it was great to win. And obviously, like, we had, you know, such a stacked team. Like, mm-hmm. We really did. And it was different feeling. It's like we really, really, really worked for it. Mm-hmm. In Dundee, you know what I mean? We really grinded. And I feel like in Cardiff, it was just like, we did it. Like, it was just like, we're expected to win. Mm-hmm. We won. It was like, that's the way it was supposed to go. In Dundee, it was like underdogs, and we fought. And mm-hmm. Yeah, it was two different feelings. But and then winning the playoff is the first time in 20 years that Cardiff had done it. And obviously, the storyline, right, the year before, I actually was in the stands the year before, and we watched Sheffield win, right, and beat Cardiff. So, and then it was weird. A year later, you're standing on the ice and you're winning it. So, yeah, it was, you know, a great group of guys. And that was the expectation. You know, we played in Champions League that year, and we were built for Champions League to do some damage in Champions League, which we got some wins. And, yeah, in that season, that was what was supposed to happen, and it happened.
Let me ask you this, Justin. What was the difference playing in the Final Four in Cardiff, where maybe not as many people are cheering you guys on at the Final Four, or when you're playing with Dundee, where everybody is cheering you on, far like the Cardiff fans? You know what I mean?
So yeah. So you got everyone cheering for you, all right, when you're the underdog, and no, it was. I don't know. It's just like that mentality. It didn't really matter, because you're like, yeah, they're not cheering for us because we're expected to win. I don't know. It's just it's like we knew we had it. It was ours to lose.
Mm-hmm.
If that makes sense, right? It's ours to lose. We should win this.
I remember in our box, I'm sure, I think you were there, Swanee, too, and it was the Stars TV in our box. I mean, everybody, I think you guys, it was the year Cardiff were playing. I forget who you guys were playing, and it might have been Sheffield, or it might have been another team that the game before. And all the box was like converted to Cardiff Devils fans just because of you. So you, when you were at Cardiff, you had the Cardiff fans, but you also on the lower, because you can see our fans from the box, right? And all our fans, like the Stars fans, were cheering on Cardiff. So when you were there, Cardiff got the X amount of more. The Dundee support, that's for sure.
Yeah, I mean, I always felt the love, and, you know, obviously with the chant, and, you know, like you said, the banners and the t-shirts and the signs, and I always felt the love. And like we touched on a little bit beforehand, my first game back in Dundee wearing a Cardiff jersey, you know, that was tough. You know, you see all these 18 Farina sweaters still, you know, hanging, and it was funny because when I scored, you know, there's some people doing the chant, and then some people didn't know what to do. And it was kind of like, oh, we're not supposed to be cheering for them. But they wanted to so bad, you know, you could feel that. And, always felt the love. And like I said, it's because we're family. That's what it was, right? They wanted to see me succeed. And even though I was wearing a, you know, different jersey, I still had their support and their love. And it was tough. It was tough games to play.
That's that. The thing that's good, Justin, I think you just show the fans, like, you know, when you and the club, and you show everybody, like, you had this, you know, when guys retire, guys move on, like, they have this special place in their hearts. Like, I have special places in my heart too that you'll always remember. And for you to have that memory and that experience in Dundee, like, yeah, the fans will always remember you, but the beauty about that is you'll always remember the fans and the experience you had here.
That's it, exactly. And I think that's what makes it, you know, those two seasons even more, you know, memorable, right? Is all those relationships and all those connections that you made, you know, along the, you know, with the ride of playing hockey. So yeah, no, it truly is.
All right, I'm putting you on the spot, Justin. So if you had to go out now to the shop and they tell you you gotta put one mask, right? So we'll put them in to not discriminate against it. So it's Rapid City, Dundee Stars, or Cardiff Devils. Which mask do you put on?
I'm putting on the Dundee Stars mask. I think I got one on order.
All right, and Justin, you're gonna wear this one too. Dundee Stars, because we launched our shop. Yeah. So we got you that one. I told you pre-show, so we'll get that one. We need to put the 18 Fear for Arena.
Large.
Justin, let's of course, one of the things people loved was the fact that you stuck up for your team under all situations. It didn't matter who it was. You were proud and your teammates meant the world. Let's have a look at some fights, but in particular I want to look at one fight. And that is the Omar Pasha fight.
Okay, I gotta go to the bathroom just now. I'll be back in like,
oh, geez.
Do you remember this? Could you give us some comments on this, Justin?
I can't believe you guys are doing this to him.
Don't hold back. But what happened here? What was the moment? Explain it all.
Let me see what's going on here.
Well, I know why. Look at the score.
Oh, it's shoved in there. And play continues in front for Farina. And the goalie covers, and passes.
What do you expect is going to happen, Pash?
Oh, right in the face.
He came right at me.
Well, you pushed over Mario.
I think things were just happening really quick there, because I think you kind of came, you snuck up on me is what happened there. You kind of came out of nowhere, and I just did my thing. Just the gloves came off. But I think that's what happened is because right at the start, right there, we're crashing the goalie there, and I'm kind of, I don't know who that was. I can't remember who that was, but, and then I turn around and Omar's kind of right there. So, yeah, so I'm battling here. I get slashed, so I'll give him a push. And then, yeah, all of a sudden, boom, there he is. So I think he kind of caught me off guard there a little bit.
Toby couldn't come in earlier or what?
Toby's not doing anything.
I should have shown that last part.
I don't know why he doesn't have his little notepad out. He had his notepad out. I'm pretty sure every time he took it out, he just wrote down 18.
See, for me, Justin,
I said, Toby, why you bother bringing out your notepad? You know, you're just going to put 18. Like, you should know that by now.
So for me on that one, I have to say, like, I wasn't necessarily expecting it, but I did look for it, you know. But also at that time, I wanted to kind of, as a player coach, you kind of want to send a message to the guys.
Yeah.
Listen, guys, it's 3-0. Yeah. And I think Justin, like, he has that mindset too. Like, if
exactly.
You're down, you want to, obviously, I'm not, you know, the Mr. down like a side of the bird. Where was my tough guy at the time?
Right,
Neiler was injured. Anyways, but
The amount of times Neiler, I think he asked me to fight every game, and Lefebvre's like, if you fight Neiler, you're gonna have to. He's like, you're gonna have to pay a $200 pound fine or something. Like, he's like, I can't afford you getting hurt fighting Neiler. Just don't fight him, please don't fight him. I heard Lefebvre begging me.
I have to say, like, you were a tough guy to play against. There was no, I think we talked a few times even after. There was never, it was always a heat of the moment. I mean, it's weird because, you know, you fight someone like Justin and you have those battles against a guy like Fitzy, and there's a few other guys in the league that you fight with, or they're all good guys and they're all competitors. They're all doing it for the right reasons. And
yeah,
you know, for us, the beauty about this, maybe we could have had my old GM, Neil Russell, and would always, if we lost in Dundee, and people have to remember, we're playing in Manchester. That's our longest trip, right? So when we were down 3-0, all I can think about is, shit, he's going to give me a fucking hard time again. And then I'm thinking about, we got to get the team going now. We got to think. And then, so.
Yeah, so you asked for the best spark. And that's what I would, actually, that kind of reminds me of, and that's the thing, right? You're down 3-0, or maybe you're on a few game, you know, skid, and you need some to get the guys going, get everyone back on track, and that spark, right? So, yeah, no, I've been there many times, and I totally get, yeah, down 3-0. Absolutely, I would have done the same thing. And actually, I think I remember that second year on the car ride to the rink with Sheepdog. We're going to play Edinburgh, and I think we were on, like, we lost, like, six or, I don't know. It was a ridiculous number of games, and it was, like, slipping away. Season was slipping away. And I remember going to Sheepdog. I was like, you know what? Like, we just need, like, an old-time hockey scrap. Like, we just got to get the guys going. Get everyone going, right? And that was the game that Sean, was it Beattie? Sean Beattie?
Yeah.
That was a game he kind of hit Seskon or something, and I just chased him, like, down the ice. I chased him all the way down the ice and just jumped on him because I was just looking for any excuse, because I knew we needed something to get things going, and I just started – I think I took the goalie's mask off. I think Lidhammer took a beating by somebody, poor guy, and he's like, why do you do that? Why do you do that all the time? Lidhammer.
Nah, that's like, Justin, you were – I think you were well known in the league to be one of those guys that can, yeah, you know, can fight, can score, and maybe even from our side, like every time we play you guys, we obviously knew that of you. You know, we knew that you had that side of you that you can provide offense, that you could do a bit of everything, even in your time in Cardiff, right, where you had that ability to do. And I think that's a great asset for any team. And for us, listen, we played against you guys and when you were in Dundee, so many, well, obviously in the conference, you, like, that second year, you guys went to the Final Four. We wanted Brayhead. I had this conversation before because we had the same feeling. But I think the fact that, you know, had a guy like you and Dundee, it just made it, because you guys weren't, like, you had you and Seske that year, right, that were pretty tough. And just the fact that you guys could not only play, but had that, like, being able to hold guys accountable and not afraid of you. So it's not only, it's not like you guys are playing 5-10 minutes a night. You guys are playing a regular shift, power play, PK, maybe not Seske on the power play, but PK, 5-on-5, and then you guys have that way of you guys that you're not necessarily looking for it, but you're
guys accountable. Yeah, exactly. Yeah, no, and every team needs that, right? Every team needs that.
Justin, see if we were to ask you one of the most underrated players maybe from the second season at the Dundee Stars that maybe people didn't notice as much, who would you say?
Matt White. He, that guy could win face-offs. He could win draws, and it was huge. Like, he was just a solid player, and he didn't put up 50 points or whatever, right? But he was so effective, and he's just one of those unsung heroes, right? And he's in there, and he's sacrificing his body, and he's working his tail off, and he's doing the little things right that go unnoticed, and killing penalties, and, you know, he's doing that. He's doing all that, and he's not getting the spotlight. So I would have said Matt White for sure is the one guy to me is an unsung hero and one of those underrated guys.
And if we talk about the not your time at Cardiff, but the Elite League in general, Just what's your best memory of the league?
Oh, geez. Yeah, the best memory is hands down, you know, defeating Rayhead and going to Nottingham. It really is. Like, that is it. You know, even though we did win a championship and whatnot, but that was just something special. And then aside from that, a four-goal night, I think, was something that I've never done anything like that before. And then another memory is actually against Cardiff. Switzy, Lidhammer, I think Switzy had a hat trick, or Lidhammer had a hat trick. I had a hat trick. We had like 6 goals or something in a Challenge Cup game in Cardiff. You know, so that was a pretty memorable game. But there's so many. Like, I mean, so many memories and takeaways. But I don't know. It's just something about going to that, going to the dance, right? Going to the prom that really, you know, it's really memorable.
Yeah, that was.
I'll tell you my first memory of Justin Farina was well, obviously off the ice we talked a bit, but my first memory of Justin Farina when I was with the Dundee Stars organization was the first day and presenting. I think it was myself or the players, and I forget what it was. And I got a question: "Is are you going to fight Farina this year?" So that was really fun. I think it was Little Stars TV that said something like that.
Oh, jeez.
I wasn't playing at the time, so I think he asked me, "Are you happy to be retired?" And I was like, "Yeah." So that's my first memory of you, Justin, in Dundee. But yeah, listen, you must have had so many memories, like playing 2 years here and playing in Cardiff. It's probably hard to picture, but the fact that you, I think the adversity is one thing that maybe people won't appreciate as much as being within the organization is the adversity of facing a lot of injuries, of being an underdog, and to, you know, overcoming those challenges, and to, you know, I guess that's really
that's what it was all about. It was that climb, right? It was climbing the mountain. It was just like you look at the Belfast, the Sheffield, the Cardiff, you know, they got the extra import, you know, guy goes down. You got backup, you're playing with four lines, you got those extra bodies, and you just don't have that, you know, and you guys get hurt and there's no one to step up and be replaced. Like, you're playing short, shorthanded, and it's more of a challenge. It definitely is. And it's just more of, you know, it's just like climbing the mountain, I guess. I don't know. It was like the chase, right? It's all about, that's what it was all about. And it was tough. One of the toughest things ever, so. And then again, with on top of balancing the Masters and being a new dad. And so it was just, it was going to the Final Four for the first time, and the see the fans and how excited they were. That was
all worth it.
Amazing. Mm-hmm. It was.
How much do you miss the Elite League now, Justin, now you've been away for a bit?
Yeah, I mean, I miss the game. You know, it's just can't play forever, and had to turn the page. And you know, it's, you know, hockey coming back on, and you kind of get the itch, and it's just, God, no, it's weird. You know, sitting in an office now, typing on a keyboard, you know, instead of scoring goals or, you know, getting into a fight. So it's just, I don't know. And then the guys, you miss the locker room and the road trips. And it's just, you know, you'd love to do it all over again. Like, it's hard to, you know, just have to walk away from that. But everyone has to do it at some point.
A few more minutes to get your questions in. So if you've got any of them, stick them in now, because this is the moment when Omar will either talk to you about salary caps or the Elite League in some way, Justin. Fans like this section of the show where we just kind of the Elite League overall with Pash. And
all right, what's one thing? Let's keep it short then. One thing you would suggest now? I guess you still follow the Elite League maybe from afar, right? What's one thing you think the league, whether there's a season or not, what do you think one thing you would like to see the league do to improve, maybe?
Geez, you know, to improve. You know, you need an independent chairman. I think that's a big one there. And I would really like to see a players union. Mm-hmm. A union, I know it's it probably never happened, but, you know, they have it in the East Coast, American League, you know, NHL, NHLPA. And it just needs something to protect the players. Mm-hmm. You really do. And having a union, you know, guys are going to get their skates like they should. Guys are going to get, you know, what was promised, you know, but they don't have that. And they got all the control. And so that would be my two cents is, you know, I'd really like to see a union in there, players union, protect the players.
That is kept short, Pash. Have you got anything to add to this?
Protect, well, now I'm on the other side, so I guess so. I mean, listen, there is, I think that, like Justin say, that's a big challenge for the Elite League. And it's ran when the structure of the league, I think, is one that I would see that we need to look at before any union is how, like, an independent chairman you would bring in and how he would want to bring those elements in involved. But, yeah, I mean, a players' union is something that would be important, I think, in any league, in every league whatsoever, where there is laws and protections under the players. But the thing with this structure of this league, like a lot of leagues in Europe, it's – listen, that's another conversation for another day because it's a challenge to financially for every team right off the get-go. But, listen, an independent chairman, that could be certainly a start where – if there is any issues and there is somebody maybe they can go to if there is issues with teams or structures. But listen, it's such a, we have this conversation every week about it. And it's a league that's driven on bums on seats. Every team is trying to do their best. I think there's a few other things like either a major sponsor, but that's up to us. I mean, GMs or owners, we have to do our part to bring more income to the league to survive and to push it to that next level. So I don't know. Listen, we have this conversation every week, right? So it's never an easy answer for that. That's for sure. But I'll tell you one thing, Justin, I'm proud to say, like, for us in Dundee, I think we've took a lot of good steps forward in the last few years. And I'll say this publicly, like, as a club, I think we took a lot of good steps as an organization. We're getting to that phase where I think we are getting there. And I think it's a slow process, but we're eventually getting there. There's a lot of things we're doing in the background. So we're trying to, as a club, we're trying to represent the club as well as we can, and we're taking that progression. So I think it costs money, and that's the other thing but that's up to, you know, ourselves to raise as much money as possible. And that's the league. I think we have to do, everybody has to do a better job in that aspect, but it's certainly a challenge every day, but we're getting there, I think.
Yeah, no, that's good. And you can see it, like, you know, even from an outsider looking in now, you can see, and, you know, you hear that things are, you know, turning around and every day you're getting better. And that's what it's all about is, you know, it's not going to happen overnight. So great job. Great job to you, Pash, and what you're doing there.
Well, you know what, Justin, it's, you've been here, right? You see the passion of the fans. You see the passion of the organization. And I think we just, when I arrived, the one thing we wanted to do is take that to the next level and improve on a daily basis. We have such a, you know, you know, your memories right now, we talked about, like, you have the memories of the rink, the memories of the club, the memories of everything. Like, we have that, like we talked about a few times, like, we have something special here that we can grow it, you know? And really? I think we just had to, obviously now COVID's hit and it's been a huge burner for every single team. But it's just that we were going in the right direction. I mean, you came back to a few times in Dundee and we had that chat. I said, those are a few things that, you know, we could have done, should have done when we were here. And you know, but that goes with guys like, you know, like that year where you guys had, it was easier for me to come to that season because you guys, there was already, the Stars went to the Final Four last year. You know what I mean? That was a big, big thing for my help too, coming to Dundee. But like I said, the growth of the club, we're doing a lot of things off the ice to try to grow it ourselves. But I think for us, we have to focus on us, and there has to be some focus on the overall league itself to create maybe an independent chairman, a union. So there is a responsibility otherwise than every single club, you know?
Yeah, exactly. No, yeah, you're right. No, he, yeah, coming off the Final Four there, a little bit of a foundation, and
yeah,
and yeah, you just keep doing it. Keep doing what you're doing.
We gotta get the 18 Farina, and then we can rock it. So we can rock it against when we play every team, especially Cardiff.
There you go.
Well, let's go through some questions. Thanks to everyone who's put questions in tonight, and we'll read out some of them. Sheepdog, Craig Holland says, I think Andy Bell gave Juice his toughest bout.
Oh, man.
I thought I killed Andy. I really did. I
can't even remember what really happened. So we were getting back late from a road trip, and we're hauling everything in from the bus. And we had the trunk. The trunk went in, and it's right in front of the office there. Pash, if you
– yeah.
And there's that coat. There's that coat rack, right, where everyone hangs their suits and whatnot. Well, they used to anyway. And so Andy all of a sudden's getting tough with me. He's like, I'll show you, right? He gets his fists up, and I kind of go, oh, yeah. And then I give him like a little like fake. And then all of a sudden he just goes flying back, absolutely flying back. And everyone's like, oh, what happened? Andy, you okay? And like here, you know, I'm thinking, geez, broke his hip or, you know, like poor guy. And oh, geez, I miss those guys. I miss Andy and the, you know, Kit Kat and Chris and oh man, good memories there as well. That's awesome.
David Morrow says, "What got you into playing hockey in the first place, Justin?"
Oh, geez. So, actually, I didn't want to play hockey. And I don't really like telling the story, but my mom forced me to play hockey. I was at hockey registrations. Well, at first I was like, yeah, I want to play. But then when my mom's like, yeah, we're going to hockey registrations, get you signed up for hockey. And I was like, oh, I don't want to play hockey. And my mom just went out and got all my equipment, my, you know, brand new hockey stick, skates. She's like, you're playing hockey. You know, there's no going back now. So I remember I was actually kicking and screaming, crying, going into the registration. And she signed me up. And my first coach actually was like, you know, you shouldn't really force your kids to play sports. And my mom's like, he's playing. And just filling out the form. And then I got on the ice. I touched the ice. And then that was it. You couldn't get me off the ice. So that's kind of – a funny story of how my mom actually is the one who got me going.
Thank you, Justin's mom.
Yeah, thank you.
But next question, Mr. Wu. Hi there, Omar, Stephen, and Justin. I've been waiting to ask a few questions. Mr. Farina, who is your favorite player currently in the league? I think you are a brilliant player.
Thank you. McKinnon. I'm a huge McKinnon fan. I am. Not so much anymore, but last year, because I follow, I'm hometown Calgary, Calgary Flames, following in that playoff series, man, did he just put that team on his back. Mm-hmm. and I just see it more and more with McKinnon in this last season as well. Like, he is a beast. He's an absolute beast and skilled player. His work ethic, his level compete, it's just, it's fun to watch.
Justin, what about in the Elite League? Who is the best player you think you've either played with or against in the whole league in your years?
In the Elite League, who is the Derek Walser comes to mind. D-man for the player coach of Belfast. Man, you had to be so careful around that guy. That's the guy that you just like, I didn't really want to like go into the corner with him because he sucked you in, right? Like he knew you were coming and he'd make a little like sauce pass through your legs and off the boards and the guy's got a breakaway or something crazy. It was just like, I learned real quick when we were playing against him, like you just give that guy his space, right? You just, you know, when he's at the point, you just get in the shooting lane, but you don't ever charge up there because he'll be like gone scoring a goal. So he comes to mind for sure as one of the top players. And then, you know, the same thing is with Andrew Hawthorne.
Mm-hmm.
How many years was it a D-man of the year? you know, I'll tell you what, I was happy to be on that guy's team.
Yeah. actually, when he showed up in the jersey, we both kind of looked at each other like, oh, he was relieved too. He's like, oh, yeah. Now we're going to have to kill each other on the ice. We can be on the same team, right? So,
yeah, he played with an edge, played with a really big edge too to his game. Really talented. No, I think he was by him and the Wolves are on the D were unreal. Awesome.
Yeah. Those are two guys that definitely come to mind there of top players. But, like Hawthorne was like 5 years or 4 years in a row, like D-man of the league. So. Or player of the year. I don't even know. I think he was MVP probably too. He should have been. I don't know.
Yeah.
But yeah, great player. Great player. And it was a pleasure being on the same team. And definitely.
Well, Nairn Brunton says, who was the toughest player you fought in the Elite League? Excluding Pasha, of course. Well, he obviously hadn't watched that fight very well.
He had to make that final part, Justin. That's for sure. Yeah. We all thought you were going to say me, so that's good.
Yeah, we had to exempt you out of there. It was Fitzy. Fitzy was just that you could feel the power, like through the punches, and every punch was like, oh my, like it was. Like you could just feel it was gonna hurt. Like it was like that. This connects dead on. You're dead. Like you're done. You know, I think about fighting other guys like a Rose Hill. It was completely different, right? It was just a guy that like he was throwing not quite as hard, but it was just like nonstop, right? Just and he kept that pace and it was coming at you and you know, getting off. It was kind of like. You throw and he'd throw and he'd throw and he'd throw until he's worn out. But it was just like that fight against Fitzy. I mean, and playing against Fitzy and he hit hard. He just standing from the net, he'd beat you up and, you know, he'd slash you when the ref wasn't looking and chop the back of your legs to shreds. And it was just like, oh, it's just, he was a tough dude, right? And so hands down, Fitzy, hands down.
Yeah.
Nori Baron says, would you ever like to get into coaching?
Yeah, I mean, I would, but then I wouldn't. It's like, oh, geez, you know, like, I don't know how, you know, somebody, I don't know how you do it without, you know, wanting to get out there and you know, contribute, like, you know, but I think it'd be tough just standing on the back of the bench. I think maybe somewhere down the road, you know, I'm sure I'll get into it once Noah gets at that age where, you know, they're going to need a coach. And I think that's probably how I'll get sucked into it. But, you know, I also think of coaching and it's, you know, you're on the road, you know, you're traveling, you know, it's that lifestyle again. So it's nice to have a break, but maybe something in the future for sure that could see myself getting into.
Yeah. Omar, for you, is it a tough one to, as Justin says there, that is it a lonely place being a coach compared to, of course, being when you're in a player?
Well, I mean, every coach gets, well, in this league, it is a bit difficult when you're alone coaching. And sometimes when you're playing, you get a bit, you know, emotional too. So you have to find that right balance. I think the best thing that ever happened was, I don't think player coaches were probably the most efficient way. Although, you know, a lot of player coaches had success. Like Lordo, you know, I was fortunate enough at my first year as a player coach to go to a Final Four. You look at a guy like Kiefer for a long time was a player assistant coach. So when it was playing, it was certainly difficult because, you know, every eye's on you technically. So, you know, every mistake is kind of like amplified. Or I don't know what's the exact word, but guys notice. Guys will notice when you make a mistake, put it that way. So your game has changed. I was behind the bench, yeah, it is. I mean, when the team is successful, you know, you like to see the guys happy and everybody's in a good mood. Obviously, there is down times. I remember this year we lost 9 in a row, and that was a dark, dark moment. But you kind of got to pick yourself up, and we made a few changes, and things went well. We were on pace to make the playoffs, and I think it would have been made some noise, maybe like Justin's second year here. So, but I say this, but sometimes when you have some people that surround yourself with, you know, like Mark maybe had those times, but he had maybe a guy like Justin to lean on, you know. And for me in Dundee, you know, I was fortunate enough a few times to have a guy like Mags, a guy like Boots. When Butch got hurt, you know, I had Butch to lean on a bit more, to add a bit more responsibility. So I think it's when you surround yourself with the good people and people that, you know, are very unselfish and are have that same mindset as you do, there is success. Like anything, you know, you have success when you surround yourself with good people. Like Justin talked about his line mates, you know, he had a lot of success with Switzer and a lot of success with Lidhammer, you know. So, that, you know, it's with the people you surround yourself, but it's definitely a challenge. I love the GM side and I still love the coaching. So it's I guess when things go well, you get the best of both worlds. And when things don't go well, like it was in December, well, it feels like the world's falling apart, but there's always opportunity and there's always optimism.
Yeah. Well, that's the thing too. Like, you know, life after hockey, you see that too in business, right? And that, yeah. And everything in life, it's, you know, the people around you, your team, and that's it. Yeah. Surround yourself with the right people.
I mean, that's the thing. You surround yourself with the, like you talked, like you're, you know, we have you, we had a few other guys of that season, you know, you had so many good people, that team, such a good group. And you know what, that makes a huge difference.
Next question, John O'Neill, did you try a deep fried Mars bar when you were in Dundee, Justin?
No. Where do you get one of those?
That probably would be like a chip shop, probably.
Chip shop. Yeah, you know what? I don't think I did, but no, I definitely like to.
What was the
sounds really good.
A side question, what was the something you missed from Dundee? If you could tomorrow just pop across to, what would you go to?
I was a big fan of Clark's Bakery.
Oh yeah.
I was a big fan of Clark's. Yeah, I loved how they're always open late. Hop over there for and treat yourself.
Clark's Bakery, they are a bit of free product placement there for you.
There you go, yeah.
Yeah, next question.
They pay you to say that, Justin.
I forgot my Clark's t-shirt.
I always plug in Weaver's Mill because he's a sponsor. Or Three Sessions. Or who else? I don't want Braze. Who else do I don't want to miss in the food category? Now I'm missing somebody. I'm going to think about that for a while.
Everybody who's a sponsor, yeah. But we'll do one more question before we look at some pictures from Liz Davidson. How's Noah's training coming on?
Oh, geez. Yeah, he's an athlete. He's bouncing off the walls and it's everything. It's every sport. It's football. It's soccer. It's tennis. It's right now he's baseball. I think we played baseball every morning for the last week. And he just amazes me. Like he'll grab a tennis racket and he's just in one hand backhand. I'm like, what? Like, how? Like, how are you just picking up a racket and doing this stuff? Like, so it's fun to watch and he loves it. And he'll get the rollerblades on because my dad actually helped me build a rink in our basement. So we got like a full size rink there. And so he's down there. I call it the babysitter because I literally just put him in there. I close the gate and keep him busy for a few hours. So it's good. And yeah, so get him doing a few drills and practicing up and he loves it. Yeah. He's a total athlete.
What sport would you prefer? Like in 10 years, 15 years time?
Oh man, you know what? He's golfing too. He's golfing. And so golf or baseball might be the winners. I don't know. Those might be the sports. if he could be, I don't know, what, a left-handed pitcher or, you know, a good golfer. Yeah, there we go.
Let's have this is our popular segment now, Omar. We'll have a look at some photos and get the guests to explain what's going on or memories from them. So let's have a few from Justin Farina here.
Oh, jeez. Wow. Look at that hair. People don't even know where I am in this picture.
No clue.
Oh, geez, that's good. I'm in the back there, in the very back corner there with the long curly hair and the green
the green on the shoulder and the my buddy there with the baseball cap, which is really weird. I ran into him at the gas station a few weeks ago. And it was just, so that's no, that was back when I played in the I would have been midget. First year of midget, 15 year. Yeah, we're all 15 years old there. And actually down below, a lot of league fans would know the name, but in the Toronto Maple Leafs hat there, that's Levi Nelson.
Okay, yeah.
So Levi Nelson, he was in Sheffield there for quite a while. And we actually played senior hockey in Innisfil together this year. But yeah, we go way back. We're good buddies.
Brilliant.
Oh, Dr. Seuss, Jersey Knight. And Jersey auction there in Rapid City. This is actually a great cause. This is the wives in Rapid City getting together and raising money for breast cancer. So it's called Bras for a Cause. And so all the wives got together, decorated bras for the guys, made them all fancy. And then we had to go out on the catwalk and raise some money. These are embarrassing. Jeez. Oh, jeez. So this was another Rapid City. That's Scott Brannon, by the way, back there. And it was Hockey in Heels. And it was basically 101 on hockey and explained the game and went through the rules so they'd understand the game better. And then obviously they got to see how the equipment goes on there. So engagement party, yeah, holding up the groom to be. Oh, this is great. So they have a Mick Rush night every year, and there's three McDonald's in Rapid City, and so it's split up, the guys are all split up, three different teams, and whoever raises the most money, mm-hmm. they get a McDonald's card. And so you get to treat yourself for, like, the winner's got a McDonald's card. It's like a bunch of free whatever burgers or whatever for like a week or something. And anyways, I'm back there and the girl's trying to show me how to make a McFlurry, and they're a little bit different in North America, but the spoon goes in and stirs it up and whatnot. So anyway, she's just like, yeah, you just put the cup on through the spoon, put some Oreos in there. And so here I am, and I press the cup into the McFlurry machine, and then the spoon goes right through the bottom, ice cream spin all over the customers. that was great. That was my, I think that was my first and last shift at McDonald's. They didn't keep me around. Oh, this is unbelievable. This is the last. So this is Noah's third birthday. Mm-hmm. And the last weekend I played, I retired here. And he skated out to the blue line for the anthem. Yeah, all by himself there. And skated back. And he was so disappointed when we went back and I gave him back to mom. Because it was his big game. Like, he was playing. Like, he was so upset that he wasn't actually playing. But, he's in tears. But, just priceless. Priceless moment there. I'll never forget. So proud of that little guy skating out there. That was awesome. Oh, yeah. That was the Kaylee, or did I say it right? The Kaylee? Yeah. Oh, yeah. Yeah. I had to get a picture of that wig. Yeah, look at the guys there. Yeah, that was fun. I remember that was a fun night. Got to do some of the dancing there, and that was a good time. And there's a little Jet, new addition, with his cool little pants there.
Yeah, that's brilliant.
Yeah.
Justin, have you got any final words for the Dundee Stars fans or even Cardiff fans, anybody who's watching?
Yeah, no, it's just, I miss every minute of it. And I'm so grateful for the ride that I had and everyone and all their support. And like I said, this whole show here, truly, you know, friends and family. And, you know, thank you for all the love. And I'll never forget that. And all the memories, I'll cherish those for a lifetime. And thank you to the Ward family and, you know, all they did for me and, for, you know, during my time there. And, you know, what more can I say? Just so grateful. And, you know, it was the time of my life for sure.
Well, from us, we are
grateful. Wear your heart on a sleeve there, Justin.
No, that's it. No, that's
one of your life's good people. Live, you have your heart on a sleeve, but I'm sure the fans will always remember you, will always miss you. I know you you always keep in touch with the Stars. I do receive sometimes messages when we beat sometimes some team. So it's good to keep having your support. So well, we thank you from everybody here, from the Stars. Everybody says hi from the trainers, the ownership, and everybody from myself. We're really appreciative of you coming on tonight. And even I got a bit emotional there, Justin.
No, thanks for having me. Thanks for having me.
Yeah, no, pleasure. Thank you. Never be forgotten. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thanks, Justin.
Good luck with your apology there, Pash.
Thanks, Justin. Well, Omar, what a show we've had tonight. You've opened up with I'm sure lots of people have loved the opening to the show. And Justin's story there and his time at Dundee. I'm sure you've had players in your long career yourself. You've noticed I've had that love from fans. But I know you've said it previously yourself to us that night when Justin returned to the Dundee Ice Arena when he had moved to Cardiff, you were surprised as well. You were like, wow, what is this? And you knew that connection he had with the fans from that minute.
No, but listen, a guy like that is always, when you leave, I think Justin, you can tell he always played hard, but he always, like, you know, when you talk about people leaving an organization, I mean, that's a way to do it, to leave a good, obviously a good legacy and the legacy that will always be remembered. So no, it's weird. We have all this now. We're living in a time that we're doing a Zoom call that normally at this time we'll probably be getting ready for the first preseason game of the year. And you know, as a club, you know, now we have time to kind of look back and to grow it. I'm a big believer in growing the club and guys like that. You know, you want to build the rapport and the legacy, and certainly he's right up there in the history of the Dundee Stars. So you know, that's why I think it's important for whether it is a season or not. Well, we need our fans to support us, to keep us going and to grow it and to create some new memories. And so guys like him can always follow the team and jump on the bandwagon, you know. So, listen, he's a great guy. I've had a chance to chat with him before. So,
yeah, definitely. Now, what's the takeaway choice tonight then, as well as you going to the post box to send Justin's hooded top that you're going to get away from?
I think Gail sends a few. Gail and Drew sent a few things to Justin here and there, so I might just ask them to send it because they'll probably know the address and everything. But for me, I don't know. We'll see what the boss wants to do tonight. Good question. You caught me off guard now. Maybe I don't know. I don't know. You caught me off guard. I don't know.
People are going to now be asking all week. They're going to wonder, what did Omar Pasha get? So next week, you must address what you went for the week before then.
I don't, put it this way. I don't really want a pizza.
Okay.
Don't know if I really want, like, well, I can't say this. Like, old players are going to chirp me if I say this. Like,
go for it. You got to say it now.
Mickey D's, but that's a Jenny move. But we'll see. I'll keep everybody posted next week.
Yeah, keep away with us. Well, now everybody is about to leave us and go to the new online store, right, where they can use that discount code, Omar, and get some beautiful
10% off till next Sunday, guys. Use it. It's a new model that we wanted to get out for the fans. A lot of the wear that you'll see were wore by players in the past, like all the savvy gear. We obviously have two great models in Chris Ingles and Craig Garrigan. You know, luckily they're from Dundee. They were the better two looking guys that we've had in the past. So we just decided for them that would be the models. So, no, it's great stuff. Last thing I want to say is, listen, this is our 20th show, right?
Yeah.
Well, thank you guys for being patient for 20 shows. So it's our 20th, I guess our 20th anniversary. So I'll celebrate that tonight. And a special shout out to Chris Smith. So Chris, I can give him a hard time sometimes, but he's a great asset for the club. He's done all the year in reviews, and he's also done all the players where they are now. So I think a lot of positives are, I can hear Swanee's dog though. That's why.
Yeah, they're barking. Sorry, Pasha. I tried to mute it out, but yeah, on you go.
No, but Chris, thank you. You're doing a good job with that. You know, we're really appreciative of that. And like I said, I think it was a good time for the club and all the time to get better and to improve. And we're fortunate enough. We have a team like you guys and Chris and everybody in the background to give our help. And you know, he's doing a great job with the Courier and the Telly. Obviously, they all do a great job. So,
yeah, no, a shout out to Chris, because that is not an easy job putting all that together. And it's almost give us a platform to tie shows to and that. So, yeah, big shout out to him. And
You know, I'm high maintenance. You guys know I'm high maintenance. So good job, everybody, for sticking on board for at least these last 20 weeks.
Yeah, 20 weeks of shows. It's incredible. We only started it thinking we'd do a few. 20 weeks later, the numbers have just continued to grow. So I appreciate everybody who has watched them and given their time, especially when me and Pasha have kept you for an hour and 42 minutes this evening, which is just unbelievable. So, yeah, thank you. Everybody have a good weekend. We'll be back again next Friday night with another show. Keep up to date on tell us what you're up to on Instagram, Facebook, Twitter. Keep interactive. We'd love to hear from you. And stay safe, and we'll see you next Friday night. Thanks, everybody.
Have a good weekend.